Hi everyone, you're watching the Virtual Amicus and I'm Jay Lodha. So today's topic for discussion is Corporate Perversity, a critical analysis of termination of employees with specific reference to the Specific Relief Act of 1963. So what happens when a private employee is terminated? Is a show cause notice required or is it mandated by the provisions of the Act? Now, the Industrial Disputes Act of 1947 regulates Indian labor law. So far as the trade unions or individual laborers or workmen are concerned, whether they are engaged in any manual, clerical, skilled, unskilled, technical, or operational or supervisory work. And there is also a requirement of giving a notice for that because there's a notice period to that effect. Now, what happens when at the whims and fancies of the employer, a private employee is terminated? Does he have remedies that are enshrined in the provisions of the Specific Relief Act? What happens when a private employee works for an enterprise and the employment is totally at will of the employer and without any reason he can be laid off or terminated? Where are the remedies available? Where does he go? Which forums, which provision of law he has to invoke and which forum he has to approach? So we decided today to seek assistance from a very special counsel who joins us from Jodhpur. Yes, that's right. So we have with us Mr. Mohit Singhvi, the founder and head of Singhvi and Company in Jodhpur. And just to give you all a brief introduction about our Amicus for today's session, Mr. Mohit Singhvi, he has worked for giants like Infosys, Wells Associates, and he carries tremendously rich and intense experience of various corporate and high-valued M&A transactions. His vision and articulate approach in his undertaking of various tasks has been divergent and has culminated into the birth of Singhvi and Company, which is based in Jodhpur. He has in his kitty wide range of experience of handling due diligence, arbitration, insolvency, litigation regarding mining, service, revenue, consumer, corporate, company, tax, etc. He has been regularly appearing before Honorable High Court of Bombay, New Delhi, Bangalore, Jaipur, Jodhpur, and also presented his clients before DRT, CAT, DCF, IDAT, and other various judicial and quasi-judicial authorities. He holds a gold medal. That's right. He is a gold medalist in NLB, LLM, and as an unmatched orator, and he's contributed constantly in the growth of Singhvi and Company, a keen learner, a workaholic who believes in continuous learning, which is the sole motivator for pursuing a course of company secretaryship. He has also taken care of the tax and regulatory practice, inter alia, overall supervisory administration. With commercial acumen and analytical thinking, he has helped the firm to offer cost-effective financial management services, accounting, auditing services, company foundation services, etc., etc. He also advises major industrialized banks and also assists various private persons in raising funds through various methods. And very soon, Mr. Singhvi is going to become Dr. Mohit Singhvi. That's right, he'll be referred to as Dr. Mohit Singhvi very soon because he's all set to be conferred with doctorate in law. So thank you so much, Mr. Singhvi, soon to be Dr. Singhvi, for taking out time on a Sunday morning. And you could have done better things, I'm sure, than to come on the virtual panel, Amicus, and give a presentation. So the stage is set, the floor is all yours. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Jay. That's quite a long introduction, I believe. But before I start speaking on today's topic, let me take the opportunity to thank Jay Lodha for doing such a wonderful job in the last odd 4 months or so. And he has been inviting all the big people around. And today he has given me the opportunity to join hands with his channel, Amicus, Virtual Amicus. A very good morning to all of you. Hope I will not be troubling you more than 30 minutes on a Sunday morning. So we today discuss the corporate perversity of the big employers against the actions which they take against the employees, right? So when I say corporate perversity, I particularly mean the employee and the employer relation, you know, the contract which binds them is solely at the volition of the employer, right? And it is per se, according to me, marred with nepotism and all such whims and fancies, which the employer in a jiffy takes action against the employee. So need to discuss the probable actions which the employer can take, because being an employee, it is difficult, you know, to include themselves in the definition of workmen, wherein the workmen can raise the industrial dispute. But here, when you are in the arena of employee and employer relation, and when you are holding some good managerial post, you cannot be included in the term, rather in the term of workmen. So what do we do in these cases? What is the remedy available under the law? Unfortunately, till date, we do not have any law to enforce such contracts. But yes, let us discuss what is the Honorable Supreme Court has said and what is the Parliament has been trying to, you know, take care of the employees. So firstly, it is to be understood that all these service contracts are, you know, majorly determinable in nature and unilateral in their drafting. So employees are generally do not ask as to whether they are comfortable in any of the contract or any of the clause in the contract. And yes, since they are not asked, it becomes a unilateral contract. The terms and conditions which are there in the agreement are, you know, moreover binding on the employee rather than they are discussed and asked before signing of the contract. All right. So what is the remedy available under the law? Unfortunately, there's no remedy available, but we need to understand the steps which have been taken by the Parliament to ensure that there's adequate safety for the employees. All right. So let us first understand that what if an employee is terminated by the employer, maybe because of some ego issues, maybe because of the non-performance, or maybe because of some political gameplay which is being done in order to ensure that the employer himself resigns, or if he doesn't, then, you know, to terminate that employee. All right. So we see when there are contracts of maybe 2 years and 3 years and the employee is not treated properly, then either he resigns, and if he doesn't, then he is terminated at the whims and fancies of the employer. Now, the moment the employee is terminated by the employer, what is the remedy do we have? The only remedy which a lawyer suggests to the client being an employee is to file a suit for specific performance. Now, when we understand the provisions of the Specific Relief Act 1963, Section 14 marks a clear embargo as to the non-performance, non-filing or non-maintainability of the suits of specific performance, which are determinable in nature. The contracts which are determinable in nature cannot be specifically enforced. Let us understand Section 14 of the Specific Relief Act. We say that contracts which are not specifically enforced. And Clause D of Section 14 says that a contract which is determinable in nature cannot be specifically enforced. Now, when I say determinable in nature, I mean, if there's any provision in the contract that if the employee wants to leave the services before the contract period, he has to serve a notice period. Now, if he doesn't want to serve the notice period and he is terminated or maybe he resigns, then what is the remedy? So as per the law, the only thing which an employee can get is the compensation with respect to that particular period of, you know, the contract which is remaining for him as an employee. So it is clear that any contract of service cannot be specifically enforced because of the embargo. Clear-cut provision under Section 14 Clause D, which says that contracts which are determinable in nature cannot be specifically enforced. Now, there are instances wherein injunctions have been sought, right, under the civil jurisdiction of the courts. Injunction is sought with respect to termination. The prayers are being made that till the pendency of the suit, the employee shall not be terminated. It's not about termination. It's about if the termination has been already done, the injunction is sought by the courts to put a stay on that particular termination. But now we have to again refer to Section 41, and Clause E is very specific in this regard. When injunctions have to be refused, 41E says, to prevent the breach of contract, the performance of which would not be specifically enforced. So now things which cannot be done directly, it cannot be done indirectly also. So the Specific Relief Act puts a clear-cut embargo that no contracts which are determinable in nature can be specifically enforced. So what is the remedy available? Now, if an employee is being terminated, we see that the Specific Performance Act puts a clear-cut embargo. Right. Now, we need to understand the recent introduction of the Terminated Employee Welfare Bill 2020, which is a step ahead, which is a step positive for the employees, at least to some extent, although there are major flaws in the introduction of the bill and it requires a lot of amendment. we need to understand what is the object. What is the object? What is the statement of object and reasons in by which the bill has been introduced? So primarily, it is being introduced to provide welfare measures for the employees who have been terminated by the employees and for matters connected and therewith and incidental thereto. Now, when we see section 1 as to the applicability of this particular bill, it says that it will not apply to all these terminated employees who has been terminated for A, B, C, D, E reasons. Now, what are those reasons? First is if it is proven misconduct. Second is cheating, if the employee is found to be involved or indulge in any cheating activities which is per se against the employer, or guilty of any, if he has been proved guilty by any court of criminal law. And if he has been indulging with any of the fraudulent means to misappropriate the money with respect to the employer. Now, it's a clear-cut embargo. So these persons, any person, any employee who fall within these category will not be allowed to take aid of this particular bill. This is the first thing. Now, we are basically concerned about the employees who are not guilty of any of these things, which are clearly mentioned in section 1 of the Bill of 2020. We are majorly concerned about those innocent employees who have been terminated, who are terminated at the whims and fancies because of the nepotism which is there in the organization. Now, for those employees, even after introduction of this particular bill, there is no remedy which has been made available. And the Honorable Supreme Court has time and again said that it is high time wherein the public employment and private employment are required to be treated equally. Likewise, in the public employment, whether we have in the state or the central law, the central arena, we say that if an employee is being terminated illegally, so the entire proceeding takes place and then, you know, there is a provision of quashing that particular termination and reinstating that employee to that particular position. And during that particular, if the termination is proved to be void and null, then the entire back wages with reinstatement and with respect, he has to be granted. But is that the same law which is applicable to the private employees? The answer is no. So where are we heading towards? We need to basically understand that these days the private employment is getting hold over the public employment. And it is high time we have a law which is equating, because we understand that we are also human. The private employee are also human. They are also guaranteed the fundamental rights. But if the fundamental right is being violated, what is the remedy? He or she cannot approach the Honorable High Court because the private employer is not a state within the meaning of Article 12. So what is the remedy available? So by various precedents, Article 141, which says that it is a binding force of the judicial precedent, the Supreme Court has come down heavily on private employers and have categorically held that in private employees, in the private employment as well, you need to create a balance, a harmonious construction has to be made so that, you know, the private employees are not being ill-treated or they do not feel as if, you know, they are being mistreated, right? And the termination is not illegal. Now, moving ahead with this particular bill, there are certain other measures which the parliament has sought to introduce. Likewise, the first is the creation of the fund. Section 2 in this regard says that the fund means the corpus fund established under Section 5. Now, Section 5, if you read, there are certain provisions which have been made that why this fund has to be created and for what purposes this fund can be used. So this fund is being created in order to ensure that the statement of object and reasons for this particular bill is being taken care. The object of this bill was to have a welfare program for the private employees, and only in order to ensure that the private employee's family does not suffer from the illegal termination, the corpus has been created so as to ensure that there are appropriate funds which are there to take care of the health of the family members. And if a termination is done being illegally, which has been proved, then the employee's family does not suffer from such the illegal and unilateral termination. Now, it is very important to read Section 3. Now, this bill particularly introduces all those actions which an employer takes when the company, when the organization is being wound up. So Section 3 is very particular in this regard. It says that an employee whose termination is being effected or an employee who's being terminated for the reasons of winding up of the organization or there are certain other reasons. Likewise, the first is economic slowdown. If an employee is being terminated because of economic slowdown and the employer is not being able to take care of that particular employee, or if the employer understands that he is being, you know, a burden to the company, then the employer can terminate. Now, in those cases, likewise, the first I said, it is economic slowdown. The second is the change in the technology in that particular field, wherein, you know, the employee seems to be not fit for the organization and he's being terminated. The third is if the owner or the director of the organization becomes insolvent or by any of the orders of the court, or the company is incurring losses and unable to retain their employees, or if there's any change in the government policy. So basically, if a company is being wound up because of any of the reasons, or if the employer terminates the employee because of any of the above mentioned reasons, which are more particularly mentioned under Section 3 of the Bill of 2020, then he or she shall be entitled to the health insurance benefits out of the fund which have been created by the central government, as I already mentioned under Section 2, that what is the fund and which is being taken care under Section 5. Now, explanation to Section 3 says that the unemployment compensation shall not be less than 60% of the gross salary of the terminated employee. Now, this is a very pertinent provision. Then we have the health insurance benefit has to be given. Then we have the terminated employee shall be entitled to terminal benefits on the cessation of the employment, like provident fund, gratuity, and leave encashment, which is there, mutatis mutandis in the public employment as well. Then, if due to any reason the employer is not able to pay the benefits arising within 1 month of the date of termination, the employer is under a duty to pay interest at the rate of 12%. Now, this is a very interesting point which has been introduced by way of this Bill 2020. We understand that most of the statutory provisions have the provision of 6% or 7% or 8%. But the government has taken care of the vulnerable conditions of the employee who is being terminated on the account of points mentioned under Section 3, because it is not his mistake that he is being terminated. So in that case, he is given proper benefit. He is being assured of health assurances, health insurances, and health benefits of his family members who are particularly and only dependent on such employee. Now, if such employee is being terminated, you understand the vulnerable condition of the family members, because the employee might have a child also. He must be getting educated in the school also. What about the school fees which is required to be paid every month or every quarter? No, so adequate provisions have been made in this particular bill to ensure that the employee's family does not suffer. All right, so this is about the Bill of 2020. But we need to understand that the chaos and the instability caused by the termination of the employees, who is going to take care of that? Is it not a concern which every one of us should come together and solve? Now, the most difficult situation is an employee cannot file a suit for a specific performance because of the bar which has been created under Section 14D and 41E of the Specific Relief Act 1963. We saw the advent of this Bill of 2020, which although does not give a foolproof protection to the employees of the private sector, but it does to some extent tries to protect and bring an equality among the employment of private and public sector, but there are still flaws. Now, what is the flaw? Now, we understand that any innocent employee who does not fall within the ambit of Section 1 and who also does not fall within the ambit of Section 3, what is the remedy available? Unfortunately, there is no remedy available. So it's high time that this bill is being relooked upon. The bill is also required to be relooked upon, particularly to those employees who are innocent, who are being terminated by big giants as per their whims and fancies. So there is no protection under the law. The Honorable Supreme Court, in the case of S.S. Shetty versus Bharat Nidhi Limited, has held that the chaos and the instability of the employment is nothing but a result of absence of legal blanket on termination, coupled with the dearth of codified legislation to administrate the employment in the corporate sector, as existing laws are lackadaisical in nature and does not even whisper about such actions. Thus, the Supreme Court has come down heavily on the private employers to say that if an employee is being terminated illegally, what is the remedy? So I believe, to my understanding, the day is not too far when there will be a law which will protect the termination of the innocent employees as well. And this bill in particular, who moves a step ahead, which is, you know, very interesting and dynamic introduction in the parliament by the existing government. This bill needs to be relooked upon. There are certain provisions which are required to be added. And then the Specific Performance Act is also required to be amended in particular to those employees who have been terminated at the whims and fancies of the employer, which is per se marred with the nepotism concept. Now, when a private employer is, you know, is having some ego issues with the employee, then the best tool which the employer has to terminate the employee, wherein he knows that the maximum relief which the court can grant or the contract can grant is the compensation in lieu of the service which is remaining. What after that? There's no provision, right? And also, the moment an employee is being terminated, bereft of his mistake, the next job which he seeks is also a troublesome affair, because of the simple reason that he's being terminated. He's not going happily from that organization. So the law does not provide any remedy. If he's being terminated at the whims and fancies of the employer, then the next job which he would definitely try to seek in order to have a sustainable living, that also will be affected by a large extent. The bill introduced is a somewhat step ahead in order to protect the employees, but then there are certain provisions which are required to be added for those innocent employees also who are being terminated. So this is all from my side. I believe I've been able to throw some light on the relevant provisions and the law dictated by the Honorable Supreme Court. And I believe the day is not too far when the parliament will have a dynamic approach and would ensure that there are provisions which are made, this bill is being amended in particular to ensure that the private employees who are innocent in their behavior also does not suffer from the abolition of the private employer. All that's, thank you so much. I hope I've been able to give some background about the law. Thank you. Thank you, Jay. Once again, hearty thanks to you for giving me an opportunity. And I believe I've been able to, act in accordance with the standards set by the virtual amicus. Thank you once again.
Such kind words coming in from our amicus for today's session, Mr. Singhvi. In fact, congratulations to you. Such lovely news that we received that you'll very soon be conferred with a doctorate in law. And now you'll be called as Dr. Mohit Singhvi. So congratulations in advance. Your treat remains due. Well, we can talk about that later, post this segment. So to all the viewers who are watching, our email is mentioned on the channel. So for any queries or any of the fundamentals or concepts, feel free to write to us. We'll forward the same to our amicus for today's session, Mr. Singhvi, who will be who's willing to assist all throughout. And it's difficult to get hold of him, to catch hold of him, to rope him on a working day. So we managed to get him on a weekend and ruin his Sunday for us. So thank you, Mr. Singhvi, once again. Thank you to all the viewers. Stay tuned. Next episode is on its way. It's goodbye for now. Thank you.
Pleasure, Jay. Thank you so much.